our foundations here at Young America's Foundation. I have the honor of working with a lot of our generous supporters that make programs like this possible for you to attend. But today it is my privilege to introduce to you Dr. Paul Kengor. Dr. Kengor is a professor of political science at Grove City College, a private Christian liberal arts college located in Grove City, Pennsylvania. Dr. Kengor is known for his courses on Middle Eastern politics, comparative politics, major European governments, public administration, and Marxism. Kengor serves as the chief academic scholar at Grove City's Institute for Faith and Freedom, a think tank and policy center which gives students unique opportunities to network, attend lectures and programming in their fields of interest, and find their calling. Kengor has been published in many major outlets, including the New York Times, USA Today, The Washington Post, National Review, The Washington Times, and many others. He is also the author of several works on Ronald Reagan, including 11 Principles of a Reagan Conservative, God and Ronald Reagan, The Crusader, Ronald Reagan and the Fall of Communism, and A Pope and a President, to name a few. He is an internationally recognized authority on Ronald Reagan, the Cold War, and communism, and nationally known for his work on the American presidency. In addition, Dr. Kengor is a huge advocate for Young America's Foundation in his classes, regularly encouraging students to take part in YAF's unrivaled programs and internships. In my comparative politics class with him at Grove City, he first introduced YAF to me and has helped me as well as many of his students find their career path. Dr. Kengor received his doctorate from the University of Pittsburgh's Graduate School of Public and International Affairs and his master's degree from American University's School of International Service. He lives in Grove City with his wife and children. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Paul Kengor.
All right, thanks, Kelly. Good job, all right. Thank you, Kelly. So we have there an alum of Grove City College, and she's done great work here over the years. So one of the many people from Grove City College that have been connected to YAF that we're very proud of. In fact, I'll give a shout out if he's watching to Andrew Coffin, who runs the Reagan Ranch Center in California, who, Kelly, he was in that comparative politics class too, but before you, 1997, so the very first class that I taught at Grove City College, Andrew was there. But it's good to see all of you, and this is a great conference. I mean, I don't know what all you paid for this, but it's worth it. I mean I saw about 2 weeks ago, right? And if you didn't pay anything, that's really good. But I saw the list of speakers a couple weeks ago, and it's just fantastic. What a great group. From Scott Walker kicking it off, Rick Santorum, Ryan Anderson, Trent Horn, Michael Knowles, everybody. Really impressive. So I think you're blessed to have this. And this is material that everybody should know. Anyone who's young and Catholic, not just young Catholic and conservative, just young and Catholic, you need to know this. You need to know this information, especially to combat the SJWs on campus. I love that. That's great. All right, so my topic is how the Catholic Church confronted communism and socialism. And your previous excellent speaker, I think, probably covered some of this material as well. We didn't compare notes and look at presentations beforehand. But if this is repetitive, that's okay. You need to know this. I'm telling you, you need to know this. And feel free, I have about 30 slides altogether, so feel free to take pictures of these different things when I'm going through here. And also too, if you'd like a copy of this presentation, let me know. I'll email it to you. My email address is pgkengor@gcc.edu. So I could say that again later, pgkengor@gcc.edu. So get it, send it around, share it with Sister Social Justice, right? You know, with whoever needs to see it. All right, so here we go. Yeah, we'll start with the manifesto. And again, I think the previous speaker mentioned this because we were talking about this a little bit. Dr. Pakaluk, just about an hour ago. The opening words of the Communist Manifesto. So the Communist Manifesto is published in 1848. And you're going to see how early your church was onto this. I'll quote Pope Pius IX's Qui Pluribus from 1846. By the way, Marx and Engels originally were going to call it In fact, there's a direct, there's a letter from Engels to Marx where Engels says this. He says, give a little more consideration to our communist confession of faith. He said, I think we should drop the catechetical form and call it simply the manifesto. So there's all kinds of mocking and aping of religious language by Marx and Engels, the communists and the socialists. They originally referred to the manifesto as a communist confession of faith, right? Catechetical form. So it opens with these words. A specter is haunting Europe, the specter of communism. All the old powers of Europe have gathered into a holy alliance to exercise this specter. And they include here Pope and Tsar. They name the Pope among those who are getting together to exorcise this specter. So imagine using that kind of language, right? Specter is a ghost. And what kind of ghost do you exorcise? Not E-X-E-R, right? You know, you don't put it on the elliptical or a treadmill, right? E-X-O-R, you exorcise a demon of all things. So the fact that they would open with that kind of language is chilling, and I think would have profound consequences. They say in the manifesto, if somebody asked you, how do you define communism? Well, say Marx and Engels put it this way, quote, the entire communist theory program may be summed up in the single sentence, four words, abolition of private property. So right then and there, I mean, my 10-year-old daughter, Gianna, could tell you, I mean, Daddy, they're going to have to kill 100 million people to do that, right? I mean, abolition of private property. You really want to abolish private property? You're going to have a bloody war on your hands. I mean, that goes against property, a biblical right, a natural right, from the cave to the courthouse, from the Old Testament to the New Testament. Thou shalt not steal implies that people have the right to property. I mean, come on. Do you know how many people you're going to have to kill to abolish private property? That's why Pope Benedict, among others, would say communism doesn't just not work economically, it doesn't work anthropologically. This goes against human nature. And you could walk around all you want and stomp your feet and say, it's not right that they have more money than... But what are you going to do? You're going to go take it away? Yeah, right? Well, you're gonna need guns. You're gonna need gulags to do this. That's just the way it is. Marx, Engels, Lenin, and I could talk about this too. Yeah, they doubled down. You are horrified at us intending to do away with private property. And then what do they say? Well, we don't really mean that. I mean, we no, precisely so. That is just what we intend to do. That's exactly what we intend to do. Good luck with that, dude. And so people who say all the time, oh, communism's a pretty good philosophy. You just read the Communist Manifesto. It talks about sharing and helping people out. Really? Have you read it? And oftentimes you'll find, no, they haven't read it. They have some sort of idea of it. Marx, Engels, Lenin, we could talk about this during the Q&A period. They said that socialism, like communism, Lenin said, Marx said, what's the difference between socialism and communism? Richard Pipes, a late professor emeritus at Harvard, used to say, there's no real meaningful distinction between socialism and communism. Marx and Engels and Lenin and the others said that socialism is the final transitionary step before you get to full communism, which is indeed what it is. So history would pass through this dialectic, this series of steps, right, stages from feudalism, slavery, to capitalism, to socialism, to communism. Marion Smith, who was with the Victims of Communism Memorial Foundation, I heard him say this one, this is a really good description. He said, when he's asked to define the difference between socialism and communism, he said, well, like Christians aspire to heaven, socialists aspire to communism, right? That's the utopia. That's the New Jerusalem, to use the language of Pope Benedict, that they're striving to. And I like that description because for these communists and socialists, even though Lenin said every socialist as a rule must be an atheist, right? You must be an atheist. But to them, they treat their philosophy like a religion. If we just do all of this, we're there. Utopia on earth. Ronald Reagan, or guy over here on the wall. used to say, yeah, communism, that religion of theirs. That religion of theirs. It's ironic because they attacked religion. More on that in a minute. The manifesto, and this is pretty remarkable too, is it not? So people say all the time, well, communism, just read the manifesto. It's about sharing, about helping your neighbor, right? Sharing things. Marx and Engels said that communism seeks to abolish the present state of things, right? Is that all? Abolish the present state of, imagine turning in a paper at the end of the semester to your professor saying, I'm going to argue in this paper for the abolition of the present state of things, right? I mean, that's quite a goal. They acknowledged their views on property stood contrary to the social and political order of things. They got it. They understood. Their 10-point plan, they say, of course, in the beginning, this cannot be effected except by means of despotic inroads. They knew that you were going to need despotism to do this. They knew that. The communist revolution is the most radical rupture, they said, with traditional relations and traditional ideas. Got that right. Close of the manifesto. Look at this line. This, I think, is really telling when you think about the protest movements around the country today. Everybody just remembers the end of the manifesto. Workers of the world unite. You have nothing but your chains to lose. In short, communists everywhere support every revolutionary movement against the existing social and political order of things. Remember that, because you'll be watching, following something on Twitter, wherever, and you'll say, "What? Why are the? What's that guy with a hammer and sickle and the red flag doing there?" I mean, they're not at that rally. They're not talking about redistribution of wealth. Why are the communists there? Well, if it's a revolutionary movement that goes against the existing social and political order of things, if this helps them take it all down and abolish and reinvent and fundamentally transform, they'll be there. The very first articles that I saw in any publications supporting the redefinition of marriage, 10, 12 years before Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton changed their position on it, was in People's World. The flagship publication of the Communist Party, Communist Party USA. I thought, why are these guys on that? Well, for them, it was about changing the existing social and political order of things. Look at this line. This is the very end of the manifesto. The communists disdain to conceal their views and aims. They openly declare that their ends can be attained only by the forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. Think about that. Their ends can be attained only by the forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. And there's no nuance here, right? Well, you know, we feel that we can reform the system and change this and here. And, you know, some of the problems with violence in America, with maybe police and so forth, maybe reform this, change that. When you see language today, like, no, you must abolish the police. You're like, well, why do you want to abolish the whole thing? But these revolutionaries are about the forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. So the person who says, oh, again, it's a pretty good book if you just read it. Have you read it? Come on, there's no more revolutionary philosophy in history than this. None. Marx called for the ruthless criticism of everything that exists. The phrase, the idea critical theory, which is like a form of Marxism applied to culture and other things, there's also critical race theory. But I think the best way that stems out of Marx is that Marx wanted to criticize everything. No. Ruthlessly criticize everything that exists. So these guys were all about taking it all down. All right, did you know that this was in there? In the manifesto? Do you charge us with wanting to stop the exploitation of children by their parents? No, we don't want to do that. To this crime, we plead guilty. But you will say we destroy the most hallowed of relations when we replace home education by social. They were against home education. Point 10 in the 10-point plan of the Communist Manifesto calls for free education for all children in public schools. One of the first things that the Bolsheviks did, shut down the private schools, shut down the religious schools, put everybody in public schools, and ban religion from them. Take the kids away from the parents. Ban all home education. You got to get the collective, right, into the collective public schools, where you can manipulate them, control them that way. Marx railed against the disgusting bourgeois claptrap about the family and education and the hallowed correlation of parent and child. By the way, there is a hallowed correlation between parent and child, all right? And it's none of his damn business. They also hated religion, moral absolutes. So this is the, you guys have read the essay, what did Marx call religion? Opiate of the masses. I've run into people too who say, well, that's not that bad. I mean, you know, for a lot of people, you know, religion is kind of, you know, in a way it's a crutch, and that's a good thing. That's what Marx meant. He's not really being it. No, read the whole essay. Read the whole thing. Religion is the sigh of the oppressed creature, the heart of a heartless world, the soul of soulless conditions. It is the opium of the people. And that essay, his Opiate of the Masses essay, he uses the word criticism or criticize 29 times. Probably the only word that he used more than criticism or criticize was abolition. Wanted to abolish everything. If you go to the website of Communist Party USA, I have to read this junk for a living. And take your Marxist IQ test, right? And if you go there right now, it's just filled with stuff on civil rights. I mean, if you were like a ninth grade teacher who was a Marxist, you could like pull that up in your classroom and say, and the kids would go home and say, Mom and Dad, I don't know why you're against communism. They're all about helping minorities and women. I mean, you should see their website, right? But they have this one section, Marxist IQ, and it said Marx was all about abolition. They called him an abolitionist. Right? If you know what Marx actually said about race, Marx was very racist. Very, very racist. All right? Marx was an abolitionist, all right, but not about race. Communism begins where atheism begins. Nice. Marx had a favorite quote from Mephistopheles, who was the demon character, the devil character, in Goethe's Faust. You ask Ronald Reagan. Hey, Reagan, did you have a favorite quote? And he said, well, you know, there was in the Bible, Isaiah in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, John, he had a passage from John, and he said, yeah, there's a plaque that I kept on my desk from my office in Sacramento when I was governor, and I took it with me into the Oval Office. It said, there is no limit to what a man can achieve if he doesn't mind who gets the credit. Ah, nice, right? Kind of nice sentiment. Karl Marx said, oh, yes, I have a favorite, right? Mephistopheles, demon character in Goethe's Faust. Everything that exists deserves to perish. Right? Nice guy. His kids said he would chant it, walk around. And this was a nasty guy with nasty ideas. I can't believe people support this stuff today. Lenin, all worship of a divinity is a necrophilia. Do you guys know what that is? Go home and tell your parents that you went to Young America's Foundation and learned about necrophilia. They'll be real happy if they learn about that. There is nothing more abominable than religion. Religion is the opiate of the masses. It's a kind of spiritual booze. You don't have any quotes like that from Washington and Jefferson and Lincoln. War on the Family, Marx wrote to Engels, blessed is he who has no family. Engels didn't have a family. He refused to marry any of the women that he lived with. And did you know that this was in the manifesto? Abolition of the family. Even the most radical flare up of this infamous proposal of the communists. Yeah, it's a pretty good book if you read it. It just talks about sharing, helping people out, right? I mean, it talks about abolishing the family. And at that point in 1848, it was already an infamous proposal of the communists. All right, so October 1917, Bolsheviks seize control. Who are these guys?
Trotsky, Lenin, and Stalin.
Good, 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 good. You got it. Stalin, Lenin, and Trotsky, right? Yep, so they seize power, a coup, three-year bloody civil war, killed about 7 million people between 1918 and 1921. They immediately tried to take this global. This is what terrified so many members of our Congress. And even progressive presidents like Woodrow Wilson were shocked by this. Marx said, it is our interest and our task to make the revolution permanent, not only in one country, but all the leading countries of the world. They said, workers of the world unite. They wanted this to be a worldwide global philosophy. They were never happy to keep it in just one country. Lenin, we've always emphasized one cannot achieve such a task as a socialist revolution in one country. Our victory will be a lasting victory only when our undertaking will conquer the whole world. See, this is like, these guys are like missionaries spreading their gospel, right? The whole world has to convert because we launched it exclusively counting on world revolution. March 1919, this is when they launched the Comintern, Communist International. More on that in a second. Lenin said, the existence of the Soviet Republic side by side with the imperial states for an extended period is unthinkable. In the end, one or the other will conquer. And look at this line. And before this result, a series of horrible conflicts between the Soviet Republic and the bourgeois states is unavoidable. A series of horrible conflicts is unavoidable. Right out of the gate, these guys are planning on violent revolution. Marx said, forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. This drives me crazy too. You'll see this all the time. Well, you know, communism is not a bad idea. The problem is it was implemented by bad guys like Stalin and Mao, right? Again, read what the founders wrote. Abolition of private property, abolition of the family, forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. These guys are implementing it. They're going by the text. So they launched the Soviet Comintern, March 1919, a full-fledged project for world socialist revolution. Trotsky called the Comintern the general staff of world revolution. So the Comintern was the Communist International. It was this group, this building, this physical group in Moscow that would organize and orchestrate the entire global communist revolution. Every country would get one communist party, and that party would have a delegate in the Comintern. Comintern would have a delegate in that host country. You're allowed one only, and you were all controlled. You all reported to Moscow. It was completely centralized. That's how it was to work. So the United States, we get ours. Comintern is launched March 1919. So ours was started in September 1919. Anyone know which city was first? Chicago, it started in Chicago. So Communist Party USA has been in New York probably for a lot longer, but it started there. The loyalty oath that they swore in the 1930s, I pledge myself to rally to defend the masses of the Soviet Union. I pledge myself at all times to be a vigilant and firm defender of the Leninist line of the party, the only line that ensures the triumph of Soviet power in the United States. So the United States would be a Soviet American republic as part of a world Soviet Union. The first main leader was a guy named William Z. Foster, who was also one of the founding board members of the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union. His 1932 book, Toward Soviet America. The head of the ACLU, Roger Baldwin, wrote a 1929 book called Liberty Under the Constitution, right? Liberty Under the Soviets. You guys reading Langston Hughes? He's required reading now in all public schools. Did you know he said this? They don't teach this. Put one more S in the USA. It'll be the USSA when we take over. Another Langston Hughes poem that you don't have to read is Goodbye, Christ, Lord Jehovah. Read that one. Moving on over for some guy named Marx, Lenin, Stalin, me. All right, Black Book of Communism, published by Harvard University Press at the end of the 20th century. They came up with a total death toll of about 100 million people killed by communist governments in the 20th century. 100 million. Now, that number is conservative. It's got to be higher than that. Here is, who's this delightful figure? Vladimir Lenin. Where? That's him today. In Red Square. A little jaundiced. They have to, you know, kind of get him out, pump him up every now and then, put some stuff in him, and give him a new waxing. But he's in glass there. So USSR, 20 million deaths. It's way higher than that. Alexander Yakovlev, who was published a book through Yale University Press, A Crime of a Century of Violence in Soviet Russia, around 2002, 2003. He was the guy given the job in the 1990s after the collapse of the Soviet Union to count the skulls, figure out how many people were killed. He said, quote, Stalin alone annihilated 60 to 70 million people. So it's way higher than 20 million. But probably the winner here, right, the butcher's bill, would be China. The latest numbers on China, at least 70 million. Cambodia, 2 million deaths. That could be 1 to 3 million killed in 4 years under the Khmer Rouge, the killing fields of Cambodia, 1975 to 79. 2 to 3 million maybe out of a population of 5 to 7 million. They may have starved to death, killed, purged 40% of the population. North Korea, 2 million deaths. That's a conservative figure. In fact, they published the book too early, the Black Book of Communism. About 2 million people starved to death in North Korea in the late 1990s. What's so sad about this too is a bunch of these countries are still communists. Latin America, 150,000 deaths, mostly from which country? 70 miles south of Key West. Cuba. Cuba, the numbers on that, about 15,000 to 18,000 shot, purged, executed. And then at least 40,000 people who have drowned trying to swim or float or paddle 70 miles to Florida. At least 100,000 people have tried to swim. Crazy. It's absolutely crazy. There's more data. I'll skip through this, but one of the things that I say here, you take World War I and World War II, combine them and double them, and then you're getting close to the number of people killed by communist governments. Reagan said communism is like a disease. It's that deadly. He said, no, more than that, it's a form of insanity that people would pursue an ideology that's this deadly, this destructive. All right, how the church responded to this, how your church responded. Very early encyclicals, right away, Pope Pius IX, 1846. Anyone know how long he was pope? Well, that's his first year. Anyone know? Good, yeah, so 1878, 32 years. So longest serving pope other than Peter, right? We Catholics consider Peter the first pope, you know, right? Right? All starts there. St. Peter's Square, right? That's, if you have a church called St. Peter's Parish or whatever, it's like named after St. Peter. St. Peter's Square, it's literally built over the body of St. Peter, right? That's truly, truly St. Peter's Square. But he's there for 32 years. Said the communism is absolutely contrary to the natural law itself, if implemented, would utterly destroy the rights, property, and possessions of all men, even society itself. When I first read that, I wasn't Catholic, and I thought, how'd this guy know this? It's 2 years before the manifesto was even published. And by the way, and it wasn't even implemented until Bolshevik Russia over 70 years later. It's like the guy had a crystal ball. I mean, this is where I first started thinking, wow, these Catholics claim that they have this thing called the magisterium, where the Holy Spirit is like speaking to it, that gives them insights into this stuff. I mean, that's when I first thought, maybe there's something to that. How could he have possibly known this? 2 years before the manifesto was even published. He said in 1849, both socialism and communism are wicked theories, perverted theories, and pernicious fictions. 1878, so he's followed by Leo XIII. How long was he Pope? Anyone know? 1878 to close, 1903, so 25 years. So between those two guys, right, if you're doing the math, so you got two popes before 1846, 1903, right? That whole time. Communism is the fatal plague which insinuates itself into the very marrow of human society only to bring about its ruin. All right, some other encyclicals here. This is the same one, 1846, Qui Pluribus. Communism is a dark design of men in the clothing of sheep, while inwardly ravening wolves. After they take their captives gently, they mildly bind them and kill them in secret. To be honest, they weren't really even doing that yet. But 100 years henceforth, that's exactly what they were doing. By the millions, tens of millions, over 100 million. How do you know that? They make men fly in terror from all practice of religion. They cut down and dismember the sheep of the Lord. Their writings teach sinning, the widespread, disgusting infection. Look at this. As a result of this filthy medley of errors, as I'm saying this, America Magazine, the Jesuit magazine, published a piece in July 2019, called The Catholic Case for Communism. You can look it up. Pull it up. They have the Bolivian leader handing to Pope Francis a communist crucifix. Jesus on the cross, right? On this like hammer and sickle crucifix. That would have gotten American Magazine excommunicated under Pius XII's papal decree of 1949. Somebody wrote, I wrote an article on it, and in the if you go to the original post in America Magazine, some of the reader comments are great. Oh, what are they going to publish next? The Catholic case for atheism, right? How about the Catholic case for Satanism? As a result of this filthy medley of errors, we see morals deteriorated, Christ's most holy religion despised. Look at this: the church attacked, the rights of people trampled, and even this, the sanctity of marriage infringed. How do they know that? To this day, there have never been divorce rates anywhere in the history of the world approaching the numbers in the Soviet Union in the 1920s and 1930s. Never, anywhere. And in Cuba, no one even knows how bad it is. Vast majority are divorced. Pope Leo XIII, this is one of those popes that liberal Catholics love. So share this with Sister Social Justice, all right? Rerum Novarum, they love Rerum Novarum. They love Leo XIII. Remind them that he did a whole encyclical on socialism, Christmas Day, 1878. We speak of that sect of men who under various and almost barbarous names are called socialists, communists, nihilists, and who spread all over the world are bound together by a wicked confederacy. No longer seek the shelter of secret meeting, seek the overthrow of all civil society. Well, that's what Marx wrote, right? He wanted to abolish the present state of things, the forcible overthrow of all existing social conditions. Oh, this is so strident and hyperbole here by the Pope, right? No, it's exactly what they wrote. Read their stuff. They debase the natural union of man and woman, held sacred even among barbarous people. The family is chiefly held together. Doctrines of socialism strive almost completely to dissolve this union. Here's another one, Pius the 11th. Kimberly, we were talking about him at lunch. Quadragesimo anno, May 1931. This is, I think, the best of the encyclicals. All right, remember this. This is section 120. You got it? All right? It's going to be a quiz after this, right? You don't get lunch. Oh, you already had lunch. I can't hang that over yet. All right, you don't get dinner if you don't remember this. Section 120. Religious socialism, Christian socialism, are contradictory terms. No one can be at the same time a good Catholic and a true socialist. It's an oxymoron. I wrote a piece for Crisis Magazine last week. You should check this out. It's called The Early Church Was Not Socialist. Remember the reading from the lectionary last Sunday, the Sunday before, from Acts? They held everything together in common. And if you have a priest who reads America Magazine, he'd say, well, this, you know, they condemn socialism today, but the early church was socialist. No, it wasn't. That's not socialism. That is not socialism. Among other things, that's a religious community. And these guys said, you can't be religious if you're a socialist. I think this is one of the best parts of it, too, of the encyclical. Those who want to be apostles among socialists ought to profess Christian truth. Openly and sincerely, not connive in error in any way. Let them above all strive to show socialists that socialist claims, so far as they are just, are far more strongly supported by the principles of Christian faith and Christian charity. So in other words, if you want to help the poor, just be a Christian. Why would you buy into an atheistic theory that seeks to abolish everything, including religion, right? Just because, socialism says these two things, and, you know, Christians support those two things. Christians should be socialists. We can learn a lot from socialists. That is an incredibly silly oversimplification. Just be a Christian. Practice the gospel. Don't practice atheistic socialism. Divini Redemptoris on Atheistic Communism by Pope Pius XI, March 1937. This one is scathing. Communism is a satanic scourge, a perversity, poison, fury, intrinsically wrong, a collectivistic terrorism, replete with hate, a plague, a catastrophe, which conceals in itself a false messianic idea. Marxists were the powers of darkness. Wow. The evil, and this is so true. Michael Knowles can tell you about this. Michael Knowles wrote the foreword to my current book. It's called The Devil and Karl Marx, and he made this point. And he's exactly right. He said, conservatives say, oh, communism doesn't work because it distorts markets. Socialism doesn't work because it distorts markets. He says, no, it doesn't work because what you're combating here is primarily an evil of the spiritual order. This isn't just an economic problem. From this polluted source, the monstrous emanations of the communist system flow with satanic logic. Here's another one, Sister Social Justice, loves Saint John the 23rd, right? What did he say about socialism? No Catholic could subscribe even to moderate socialism. So, right, Sister Social Justice might say, well, that's communism that right-winger Kengor is talking about, right? I'm a socialist. I'm a democratic socialist. I'm a moderate socialist. John the 23rd says you can't even subscribe to that. Socialism takes no account of any objective other than that of material well-being. It's a strictly materialist philosophy. It denies the immaterial. It denies the supernatural. It places too severe a restraint on human liberty. All right, I'm watching the clock. I got to skip ahead of some of this. This is, I wrote a book called A Pope and a President on Ronald Reagan and John Paul II and their attack on how they defeated Soviet communism. I'm going to have to skip through some of this. Carol Wojtyła. 9 days in Poland, June 1979, his first trip there. Look at that mass, 2 to 3 million people, right? Who's that? That's the guy who shot him. 9mm Browning, 4 shots fired, hit him twice, 1 in the hand, 1 in the stomach. Mehmet Aliasha, right smack in the middle of St. Peter's Square. There he is, collapsing into the arms of Father Zhivich, who's now Cardinal Zhivich in Poland, collapses. It was the feast day of Our Lady of Fatima that happened, May 13th, 1981, who appeared to these three kids. All right, who are the three kids? That's cool if you don't know Lenin, Trotsky, and Stalin. It speaks much better of you if you know the name of the three kids. Lucia, Jacinta, Francesco, right? Francisco, right. So she appeared to them May 13th, 1917, predicted three things: the end of one world war, the start of another, the rise of communism, Bolshevik Russia, spreading its errors. By the way, this, to me, when I first learned about this too, I wasn't Catholic. I said, there's no way these kids could have been making this up. What 9-year-old is gonna say, she told us that Bolshevik Russia and communism would be spreading its errors and crimes? I don't know what any of this means, Father, but I mean, right? I mean, they're in a little farm in Portugal. They couldn't have known any of that. And then the third secret, which John Paul II had not read yet, predicted an attack on a bishop in white who's shot. Looks like he dies. Who's the only bishop in the church that wears white? Bishop of Rome, the Pope. So John Paul II thinks about this. This happened 40 years ago, about right now, so May 13th, 1981. And he said, you know, two thirteenths of May. He was this totus tuus pope, this Marian pope. When his mother died, his father took him to see the Madonna in Poland and said, this is now your mother. This is your mother. And he's thinking, May 13, 1981, May 13, 1917. So he asked to see the third secret of Fatima, and it's brought to him by Cardinal Sepper of the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith in Portuguese, the original Portuguese and Italian. And he reads the third secret. And Zhivich said, when he was finished, all his remaining doubts were gone. He said, this is me. This third secret applies to me. This is it. Predicted the communists would attack a pope. This is me. So that's I focus on this in that book, A Pope and a President, and I spent about 300 pages on this one issue. The Soviets ordered the hit on the Pope. It was the Soviet GRU, military intelligence, that did it, with the approval, the go-ahead of the KGB. The communists tried to kill the Pope. All right, so it eventually collapses, communism, 1989. There's Reagan taking a chunk of the Berlin Wall. All right, I'm going to finish up here. I got just a couple more slides. When it all collapsed, Pope Benedict XVI, he made this statement in Spes Salvi in 2007. I think this is really insightful, as everything from Benedict always was, right? Marx presumed that with the expropriation of the ruling class, with the fall of political power and the socialization of the means of production, socialism and communism, if you Google Merriam-Webster's socialism, it'll say common ownership of the means of production. The New Jerusalem would be realized if you just do that. Marx thought that once the economy had been put right, everything would automatically be put right. His real error is materialism. Man, in fact, is not merely the product of economic conditions. And it's not possible to redeem him purely by creating a favorable economic environment. The problem is that they think if you can just solve the economic problem, you could have utopia on earth. You don't need religion. You don't need the immaterial. The problem is that man does not live by bread alone, as Christ told Satan. These guys really think that man lives by bread alone. Just solve the economic problem. Just redistribute wealth better, and everything will work out. But that's not how we're made. Even Pope Francis agrees. December 2013. The Marxist ideology is wrong, said Francis. The rest of that line is, but I've met many Marxists in my life who are good people. I have to include that, right? He did say the Marxist ideology is wrong. But I got to tell you, too, that's like the only thing he said about it. I mean, nothing else. We could use about 30 or 40 statements from him like that right now and like a full encyclical on it. Believe me, I collect this stuff, all right? That's all he said about it. That is it. We could talk about him if you want to, Q&A. All right, last slide. This was a battle, a righteous battle that we won. This is one of my favorite sections of the Catechism, section 409. Remember this. This is part of dinner too. So section 120, Quadragesimo Anno, section 409, the Catechism. The whole of man's history is the story of dour combat with the powers of evil. Stretching, our Lord tells us, from the very dawn of history until the last day. Finding himself in the midst of the battlefield, man has to struggle to do what is right, often at great personal cost to himself or herself. So you guys need to stand up for this stuff. John Paul II took a bullet. So did Reagan, right? 40 years ago, right now. Stand up for this stuff. Stand up for what's right. Tell the truth. You know, just because someone calls you a name on Twitter, who cares? All right? You stand before the pearly gates someday and say, well, you know, Jesus, I could have done that, but I didn't want to be called a hater on Twitter, right? And you're standing there next to some saint who, when she was 14 years old, was eaten by a lion in the Colosseum. How lame, right? He's going to look at you and say, how pathetic that is. You don't want to be called what? A hater on what? Right? Stand up for what's right. You know, throughout all of history, it's the story of dour combat with the powers of evil from the beginning of time to the very end. So the battles that you're in your lifetime, stand up and fight. Fight for truth. Be not afraid. All right. I'll take your questions. Thank you very much. How are we doing on time?
We're doing great.
Okay, good. Ask me anything. Anything.
I'll get things kicked off over here. So what do you think are some of the most pressing battles that this generation is going to have to face as they kind of get outside of high school and college as well, but into just with what they might have to face with their own kids someday?
Well, with the number of young people who are supporting socialism and even communism. So for a while now, going back to 2010, I collect data on this stuff. It was that year that more people said that they supported socialism than capitalism. And something like 57, 59, 60% of Democrats say that they would vote for a socialist for president. By the way, in 2016, 13 million of them voted for Bernie Sanders in the Democratic primary, who's a lifetime socialist. And was a supporter of the Trotskyist Socialist Workers Party. So they made good on that. And then and Trump got 14 million votes in 2016, the Republican primary. Bernie got 13 million. He got almost as many votes as Trump did. And then Bernie came in second in 2020 as well. So they're voting for socialists. They are the hot new thing right now is democratic socialism. You got problem on your campuses. The Democratic Socialists of America, the DSA. I did a brochure for you guys, right? Democratic Socialism Reality Check. Do we have copies of those? Are they getting copies? Maybe we could hand those out. The Democratic Socialists of America has chapters on over 200 campuses. They now have 90,000 members. Hey, who's a member of the DSA? She's the poster girl for the Democratic Socialists of America.
AOC.
And who's even further to the left of her in the House? You got to think a minute. You're like, no one's. Well, yeah, I got it. Who? Ilhan Omar. She's a member of the DSA. And the woman who called for the abolition of police and no incarceration 2 weeks ago. The third member of the squad, Rashida Tlaib. All three are members of the Democratic Socialists of America. Yeah, they're thriving on college campuses. And there's even 20, 25% of people out there now, especially millennials, right, saying that they would support abolition of private property. You know, it's so ridiculous, right? I support the abolition of private property, right, with like a Starbucks, you know, next to them. It's like, no, you don't, right? Point three of Marx's 10-point plan, abolition of all right of inheritance. Come on. Right. So if your parents want to leave you all their money when they die, you're going to say no and give it all to the federal government? Actually, no, they won't. They'll just give all of your money from your parents to the federal government. See, that's how it works. The Green New Deal might ban all flights across the country, but AOC isn't going to stop flying across the country because, you see, the managerial class, they need to have those perks because they need to run everything. So socialism is for the masses, not the masters. It's for the ruled, not the rulers. So there's always separate rules for all of them. Patrice Cullors, who runs Black Lives Matter, you probably saw this, right, bought 4 new purchases of homes in the last 4 or 5 years. And I've read her memoirs. She does indeed write in there that we are trained Marxists. Alicia Garza, we are super versed in ideological theories. We spent a whole year reading Marx, Mao, Lenin. The intro to the book is by Angela Davis, who's the most famous female communist in America. She ran for vice president when the Communist Party USA took in 1976, 1980. And she writes the foreword. And Asada Shakur, the lead quote is from her, you have nothing to lose but your chains, quoting Marx. Asada Shakur is in Cuba, where she's been for 30 years in exile after she was sprung out of prison after serving time for the killing of a police officer in the New Jersey Turnpike in the 1970s. So all of this stuff, you have people now suddenly supporting all of this in a way that I couldn't have imagined in 1989, 1990. The other issues, Kelly, are the sexual cultural issues. And those are the ones where you're really under the gun. Right, all the gender stuff, on marriage, those are going to be the toughest battles for you to fight. That's where you're going to get canceled, right? But again, when you're standing next to Saint Barbara, right, someday, and it's like, well, I didn't want to be called a homophobe on Twitter, right? You're going to be pretty embarrassed. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Michael Moreno. I was wondering, what do you think makes communism so enduring and attractive, and why is it so difficult to root out, even in the Catholic Church?
I have no idea. I don't understand it. It doesn't make any sense to me. It doesn't make any sense. Anybody who reads this stuff or knows any history or follows any of it, I just can't believe when I'm reading it that people take it seriously. I just can't believe it. Which is why I think it almost requires a spiritual explanation. It does not have a rational explanation. You read through that 10-point plan, and I don't care how young and inexperienced you are, but abolition of property, land, abolition of all right of inheritance, more equitable distribution of the population across the countryside, right? They wanted to redistribute not just your stuff, but you and where you live. I don't know how anybody reads this stuff and says, well, this is a really good idea. I honestly don't get it. I don't. I honestly don't get it. And you know, I don't want to sound condescending and mocking and arrogant, but you read the stuff and you just think, I don't understand how anybody could support this. Especially anybody with a business mind, right? Imagine you're starting a business, you have all these questions, you look and say, okay, all right, I got you here, okay. How is this going to happen, right? How are you going to do this? And then at one point, this proletariat rises up and the state is abolished and the society and democracy is abolished too. And then who takes over and when and who says that? And who makes this decision? You just immediately you're going to say, I don't know how you can do any of this. I don't get it. I don't know how you can put it in place. By the way, even Lenin himself said in one of his most famous writings, What is to be Done? He said, this is why you need a vanguard, a cadre, a group of leaders to organize this. Because the masses can never just be the masses. Even Lenin said, what the heck is that? Right? you're going to need a group, and then that group is going to need to raise the consciousness and educate the victims to know they're being victimized, to know that this victim group will serve as the redeemer group. And all of communism ever since has been about finding the latest victim group, right? The latest group that needs the social consciousness raised. But I don't know why it has any power, except for ignorance. So this is where you guys come in. Mm-hmm. Learn this stuff and go out and teach it. Fight the battles on social media. And they might take you more seriously than an older guy like me. I don't know. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, sure.
Hi, I'm Emma Raymond, and I'm from Our Lady of Mercy in Rochester, New York. So my question is kind of about how young people today like idolize politics and political figures, and they kind of deny the righteousness of human nature. So I'd like to kind of hear your perspective on that and maybe how to combat it.
Yeah, no, there's a lot of that. Lenin called it hero worship, right? Mm-hmm. Saint worship. And in fact, Lenin worried about communists and socialists doing that with other socialists. Then of all things, they take him and they put him in a shrine and preserve his body like they would a saint. Right, if Lenin could stand up and hit his head in the glass inside, they say, "What are you guys doing?" But they do. And people like I mentioned AOC, I mentioned the Squad. You go to the website of Democratic Socialist America and these other groups; they're selling T-shirts of the Squad, and they have these sort of Che-like images. They are I called her a poster girl. She kind of is, right? She's a celebrity. She's not just a politician, but a celebrity. And not to sound too mean to her, but that's somebody too who, she just doesn't have much life experience. How would she really know all this stuff about businesses and economics? Did she ever run a business? I think she worked maybe as a barista at one point or something like that.
Bartender, yeah.
Yeah, but there's a lot of kind of arrogant ignorance of people who don't know the stuff enough, but still have a really hard opinion on it. And then you add to it, and maybe this might have to do with the human dignity question, the lack of civility and the brutality and the meanness and cruelty of people to not just disagree with somebody, but they feel they have to destroy you, right? I disagree with you on that. You should be fired, right? You know, your income should be finished, right? I don't care if you have a family, right? You are a, and they come up with some sort of name for you. So they are, they're guilty of the very hate that they claim to oppose. They're guilty of the very intolerance that they claim to oppose. And I think one thing as Catholics that we need to teach people, and Ronald Reagan, of course not Catholic, but Reagan was so great about this, treating people with kindness and charity. And Reagan could diffuse situations so often with a joke. Reagan was a cheerful warrior, and we need more people like that, people who are smart and can do it with a smile. Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio, right? Yeah, people who are better at debating that way. And respecting people as people and respecting their human dignity.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hope that helps. Sure, thanks.
Hi, I'm Lily, and I was just wondering, who's your personal inspiration?
Oh, I don't know. I can't really say I have one. I've got a few favorite saints, a few favorite biblical figures. I guess I'd have to say Jesus would be it. is today the feast day of St. Catherine of Siena? It might be. She's one of my favorites. John Paul II is a favorite of mine. That's an inspiring story. I was telling people at lunch, the culture can be so nasty and so disgusting, and you're so disgusted by it all the time. The one thing I started doing a few years ago is when I go to bed at night, I turn off all electronics, I turn off the TV, and I read a biography or a book about or by a saint. That way I go to bed with something edifying. Something positive. And I think that's a good, at some point you have to put this political, ideological junk behind you, turn off the TV and just move on. And worry too about helping people in your own life and your own family. But those would be some of my inspirations. I love Catherine of Siena. She's one of my favorites.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Catalina. I'm a senior at Oakcrest School here in Vienna. And I wanted to ask you how we can fight against and try to like debunk critical race theory, especially yeah. since it's so closely tied with communism, as we've seen, like you briefly mentioned, with the chaos in the streets.
Right, right. And it was something that I've always avoided like the plague, critical race theory. And I've been asked to write a number of things about it ever since, and I've been staying away from it. In part because there's only so many battles that you can fight. But one thing where you see critical race theory is in common with Marx and Marxist thinking is the way they see everything through the prism of one thing, and in this case, race. And they see everything critically. And Marx, everything was seen through the prism of economics and class. And there, everything was ruthlessly criticized. So, you know, Marx, if you read, he has this horrible essay on the Jewish question where he's really ripping into Jews, which is ironic because he was ethnically, he wasn't a religious Jew, he wasn't a practicing Jew. But he says, what is the worldly god of the Jew? Money, right? What does the Jew worship? Haggling. And he focuses, and he's always accusing other people of being focused on money and greed. And yet if you read his writing, it's like, no, Marx, you're obsessed with money. And you see that a lot, too, with liberals and leftists, right? When they're screaming at you, you hater, right? And you're smiling. Well, I don't feel any hate at all right now. What are you talking about? You hater! And they keep screaming and screaming. They kind of project onto you what they're feeling. Mm-hmm. They do this all the time. I think they do it with race, right? And, you know, they'll accuse you of racism in a situation. You say, I'm not even thinking about race here, man. What are you talking about, right? What does this have to do with race? They're obsessed with race. They see everything through the prism of race. Things like the 1619 Project, it's about reexamining all of America all over again through, like, one lens only, race. And so they can't stop and look at other things that the founders did that allowed freedom of speech and other things in the process, Constitution and so forth, that allowed Lincoln to do what he did in the 1860s, that allowed for the abolition of slavery. They just, you know, it's race, it's all they think about. So everything is criticized through the lens of race. And that's what Marxists did with economics and class theory. By the way, there are gender Marxists. There are Michel Foucault, who's one of the guys behind critical theory. There are Marxists focused on culture, cultural Marxists. If you look up cultural Marxists on Google, it pops up white nationalist anti-Semitic conspiracy theory or something like that. It's insane. I have no idea who wrote that. I wrote two articles for American Spectator called Cultural Marxism and Its Conspirators, Part 1 and Part 2. Read those. The cultural Marxism is not an anti-Semitic conspiracy. Marxists have been writing about culture since Gramsci, all right, and you know, before that. But that's the danger of this. And so when you're thinking right now, why are they so focused on race? It's all they think about. I know it's all they think about. Maybe if they could instead focus on charity, right, or forgiveness, or decency, or the cardinal and theological virtues. Look at things through a Christian framework. Like Pius IX said, you want to help people, right? Don't do socialism, do the Christian gospel. Same thing. Everything you need to combat racism and racial injustice is in the Beatitudes. It's in the Christian gospel. Just go there. You don't need to go to critical race theory, especially if it's being trumpeted by somebody who's an atheist, which in some cases it is.
Thank you.
All right, sure.
Hi, and my name is Joseph. I'm with a Seton Home Study School, and I wanted to ask you, how do the communists influence elections?
Well, that's a good question. I could say a lot about that. How much time do we have, Kelly?
A few minutes.
A few minutes? Yeah, I wrote a 700-page book called Dupes. But among other things that they'll do, boy, it would be a kind of a quicker example. But they are they create front groups and front movements. They've done this for a long time. They're very devious about it. And they used to create front groups with names like the American League Against War and Fascism, the American Peace Mobilization, which they changed to the American People's Mobilization. So they will often, now you know what I have in mind, I don't know if I should say it, it's on the camera here, but they will create causes and movements and organizations with names that no one could oppose. And it's like, how could you oppose that group? Are you saying that they don't matter? Right? No, I'm not saying that at all. I totally agree with the name, the slogan, but I want to know what the founders of the group think and believe. What's their goal? What's going on here? So they're really, really, really good at that. They're great at coming up with slogans and sloganeering that gets people to do the things that they want. And they're also, they're very careful with elections, who they endorse and who they don't endorse. Did you guys see, it was last summer, I got the email right away from about 10 people. It said, communist leader endorses Biden for president. And I thought, no. They, Communist Party USA never does that. They're too smart to do that. I mean, they totally, just go to their website. I mean, they support the Democrat, totally, right? But they don't say that. And so I clicked it and I followed it. And it was Bob Avakian of Revolutionary Communist Party USA, who used to go by Chairman Bob. If you go to, look up the website, Revolutionary Communist Party, and it's called The New Communism, with a message by Bob Avakian. And he's the guy that endorsed Biden. So he was, in that case, he went right out and flat out endorsed him. But they do things, and they're behind campaigns, and they're behind Twitter campaigns and everything else to get behind a certain cause or a certain movement or idea in order to support their candidate. They do this all the time. Go online to any of the chat forums for the Democratic Socialists of America and see what they're talking about. They're focused right now. The kind of the three pillars for the Democratic Socialists of America currently is police reform, climate change, and abolishing student debt. None of which have anything to do with anything Marx talked about, right? But for these socialists, these democratic socialists, those are the issues that they're going to trot out there. Angela Davis, watch her speech. She was one of the honorary co-chairs for the Women's March in Washington, D.C. A sea of thousands of young girls wearing those pink hats. And there's Angela Davis, co-chair of the Women's March, the leading female Marxist ever in the history of America, giving this speech where she didn't once dare mention Marx or Lenin, even though she received the Lenin Award in Moscow in 1979 from the Kremlin. She's pictured with Erich Honecker, who built the Berlin Wall. There she is with Castro. But next to Madonna and the Judd Girl and all the others, she's talking about Chelsea Manning, climate change, and gay rights, right? She's not going to stand up there and quote the manifesto. She's not stupid. And she says something like, woohoo! Right, to go home and tell her mom and dad, I want to get a poster of Angela Davis. She's great, right? They're very, very good at that. I tell people all the time, they're the greatest liars of all time. These guys, they really are. That's a bad way to end this talk, isn't it? All right, anything else?
I think that's the last question.
We Let's good?
Dr. Kengor
All right, thanks, time. Kelly. Thanks, everybody.
Students, you all have a